Hello friends, I am back with my second video. It's for BSHF 101 unit 2. It's named as Evolution of Humankind. Introduction. You have learnt in unit 1 why care is necessary in developing a scientific method for the study of human beings. They assimilate and represent both nature and the culture. They share biological characteristics from nature and also overcome them through their superior intellectual, creative and cultural abilities. Evolution of human being is a long one, from the stone age to electronic and the nuclear age. In this unit, we offer you evidence of how this evolution took place. However, here we shall limit our discussion up to the Iron Age. The specific natural abilities of human beings contributed to their cultural and technological success in forging tools, adapting to natural environments, and making inventions. All these led to growth of successive stages, periods of social and cultural changes. Some of the remarkable contributions resulting out of this evolutionary transformation include division of labor, agriculture and industry, urbanization and revolutionary leaps in the field of knowledge. It also contributed to the growth of various religious systems and their philosophy. Scientific knowledge too grew together with this process. The interaction between human endeavor and natural forces always creates problems of adaptation. Too much exploitation of nature alters the balance of relationships between nature and man. The adaptation of human beings to nature has therefore been always a matter of great social concern. In this unit, we introduce you several aspects of the relationship between human beings and the nature that contributed towards the march of human civilization. It's a tool making or using an evolutionary perspective. It is often believed that some advanced primates may have used bones and stones as tool, but with the coming of the Homo sapiens, tool making and tool using began in the true sense. Only those tools as we know them emerged. The human being is an animal that not only uses tools but also constantly improves upon them. It is this tool making ability that has brought us to the present stage. Had it stopped at some stage, then perhaps the world would never have been what it is today. You may be interested to know that the first human being ever to have lived in a complete environment dates back to about 50 lakh years. He is known as the Peking Man. On the basis of the tool making skills of human beings, archaeologists have arranged human history into the following periods: the Stone Age, Old and New, the Bronze Age and Iron Age. However, all the stages did not evolve simultaneously in all parts of the world. If one region witnessed the Stone Age, in another region Bronze Age had started, and in the third region Iron Age had come. Old Stone Age or the Paleolithic period begins somewhere between 5 lakh years and 2,50,000 years ago. In the Old Stone Age, human beings lived entirely on hunting, fishing and gathering. The tools they fashioned from stone for this purpose were rudimentary in character. These tools only enabled them to live off nature and not to invest in it. Their requirements were met through trapping, hunting, plucking or digging. They had no control over nature. Rather, they were dependent on it. In cultural evolution, this period is described as a stage of savagery, as depicted by Morgan, a British anthropologist. Roughly chipped flint served a variety of purposes, from killing a prey to removing the skins, to digging up roots and tubers. The New Stone Age. The New Stone Age, or the Neolithic period, began some 10,000 years to 12,000 years ago. In this age, human beings were able to increase and thus control to some extent the supply of food. They did this by cultivating cereals and breeding animals. This period also provided us with evidence for the existence of granaries or stone houses, which imply that food were often produced in excess of current requirements. The cultural characteristics of this period correspond roughly with what Morgan called the Barbaric Age. It is during this period of Neolithic Revolution that poetry, the technique of spinning wool, flax and cotton into threads, come into use. Finally, fashioned stone axes sharpened by grinding also made their appearance at this time. The Bronze Age. The next revolution in tool making come with the Bronze Age about 5000 years ago. That is around 3000 BC. This period supported an urban population, skilled craftsmen, traders, priests and writers. Now the principal metals were used for making tools and weapons. This period is described as the Bronze Age. The revolutionary implications of the Bronze Age may not have been possible if human beings had not discovered the ability to mold, melt and fuse copper. By 3000 BC, not only was the technique of mixing copper and tin to make bronze known in India, Mesopotamia and Greece, but the wheel also had been discovered. The application of the wheel revolutionized transportation, and two-wheeled and four-wheeled carts were being commonly used by this time for a variety of purposes. By this time, wind too was being used as a source of energy, primarily to aid water transportation. We find sailboats being used from Polynesia to Egypt. The ruins of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa tell us of the application of kiln-fired bricks, which meant to use expenditure of fuel and ability of the artisans to control high temperatures. In the Bronze Age, there are evidences to suggest that land was systematically reclaimed from swamp and desert, and record quantities of food stuffs were being produced. Artificial waterways also helped to protect society against the vagaries of the water. The Iron Age. Iron Age commenced at around 1200 BC. Unlike copper and tin, which are quite rare and hence expensive, iron is one of the commonest elements founding the earth's crust. Here it should not be taken to mean that iron was a commonly available metal at that time. In the beginning, it was, however, a rare metal. The extraction of iron from its ore follows more or less the same technique as with the extraction of copper. The secret of its production was, however, kept closely guarded, and it took several years for this knowledge to seep slowly through a variety of sources before it was universalized across several cultures. In the period of the Bronze Age technology, large empires had emerged in Greece, Asia Minor, Mesopotamia and Egypt, etc. The invention of iron tools and weapons by the barbarians of Eurasia posed a major threat to these empires. Iron was used in India around 1000 BC, and excavations show that iron weapons such as arrowheads, spearheads were used commonly in western Uttar Pradesh from about 800 BC. In the words of Gordon Childe, cheap iron democratized agriculture and industry and warfare too. Any peasant could afford an iron axe to clear fresh land for himself and iron plowshares wherewith to break up stony ground. In the past, the superior tools and weapons were rare and expensive. The discovery of iron leveled these differences. Tool making, using, and march of culture. Human beings of every race, creed, and color possess identical abilities and are all homo sapiens. From Paleolithic time, human beings were not just a tool making, hunting, and procreating species. They possessed a spiritual culture, had a vivid notion of spirit, and performed sacrifices and buried the dead with considerable ceremony. This is not all. Their spiritual culture was enriched by printings, etchings, and engravings. In the Neolithic age, you find yet another great leap in the culture of human beings. With the ability to grow wheat and barley, control over livestock, and advances in the art of poetry, there took place quite a substantial development of culture. Many inventions and discoveries of this period, such as the zimurgi or brewing beer or the making of poetry, are attributed to the work of Neolithic women. While man cleared field, made huts, hunted, looked after livestock, and manufactured the necessary tools, it was the women who tiled plots, cooked, spun, and baked earthen pots. They also manufactured ornaments and articles for magical and spiritual ceremonies. Social institutions and interactions. The Neolithic human beings were, however, still quite isolated. Their villages were generally self-sufficient, and the production of food was just about enough to support the existing population. These villages were generally situated in oases surrounded by desert wastes, or at the foothills of mountains, or in clearings in dense forests. Specialization and division of labor. The use of copper or bronze brought about another revolution. This age gave rise to specialists such as metallurgists and craftsmen. They began to form guilds and clans which jealously guarded the tricks of the trade. The coming of metal tools also made way for the development of a permanent ruling class. There was more interaction between different small settlements or villages. Women were also being displaced as the plough changed the technology of farming from plot cultivation to large-scale agriculture. While the women generally used to plots, it was the man who ploughed fields. Urban Revolution. During the Bronze Age, an urban revolution also took place. Sumer and Akkad were two great urban civilizations of this age. Towns became centers of a number of activities. Here, temples were constructed with the labor of hundreds of workers who had to be supervised and directed. To do this, an architectural plan had to be drawn in advance. These outlines were laid out with the aid of strings. In India, not surprisingly, therefore, the ancient knowledge of architecture was called the salve, string, or sutra, salve sutra. The impressive temples thus constructed also needed to be administered. Records of receipts and expenditures had to be kept. This spurred the invention of script writing around 2000 BC. as worship was so highly institutionalized, here it was natural that a specialized class of priests should also emerge. These priests were the first carriers of the literary tradition, and quite predictably, literary records generally portray the perspective of the priestly class. The disparity between the rich and poor grew at an alarming rate from this time onwards. Extortions, ill-treatment, slavery, and all kinds of exploitations were practiced by the rich upon the poor. This was made possible because of the technical sophistication that human beings acquired in the Bronze Age. This sophistication brought about surplus in food production, giving rise to stratification and formation of social hierarchy. The arithmetic, astronomy, medicine, and theology developed at an impressive pace. Egyptian science approximated the sign much more accurately than before. The solar calendar was developed in the Nile Valley, Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa, which were urban civilizations of a later Bronze Age, also shared the characteristics of this revolution and knowledge with other Bronze Age civilizations. Along with the production of surplus food, superior tools, and growth of learned class, one also finds increasing institutionalization and ritualization of religious systems. Rise of great religions. Bronze Age showed further refinements in the intellectual development. The Indus Valley civilization is a unique example of this. Further, we all know about the high intellectual levels of the Vedas and the Upanishads. These great texts not only deal with day-to-day matter of life, but delve into the mysteries of life and other philosophical aspects. They describe in great detail the religious doctrines and life of the people. The growth of religious doctrines took various forms. Gautam Buddha came out with his preachings and attained Nirvana around 500 BC. Around this time, or perhaps a century earlier, Lao Tse and Confucius preached Taoism and Confucianism in China. Eastern Iran saw birth of the great prophet Zarathustra. Around the time the Iron Age began in Iran. Thus, we see a tendency in the Iron Age towards the differentiation in the religious traditions of the Bronze Age priests. The most compelling problem in Iron Age theology was to reconcile the individual with society. Soon, both in Greece and India, philosophy took a new turn and began to look at nature as comprising several constituent parts. This gave rise to the theory of atoms in Greece or Anu in India. Nature and human beings, adaptation and interaction. It is quite tempting to explain racial and cultural differences on the basis of climate and geography. You have seen this from earlier review of the developments in science, technology and tool-making ability of human beings and their advances in culture, science and religion. Such human differences cannot be understood through differences of geography. The impact of the Bronze Age or the Neolithic Age was not limited to any one geographical area, but spread all over Europe and Asia. Even the long darkness of the Paleolithic Age was shared universally as were its many artistic and spiritual attainments. Patterns of adaptation. Even so, it is worthwhile to consider how the human being as a tool-making animal adapts a nature and also tries to tame nature. The Eskimos in the remote Arctic regions have adapted to their surroundings. One finds people of the same environment often have very different ways of life. For example, in Rajasthan, We find the nomadic tribes as well as people living in the settled communities. Human beings, therefore, are relatively freer from their environment than other creations of the nature. But environment places certain constraints on human beings. The Eskimos must have warm clothes, while tribal Santhals can afford to even go naked. The Eskimos cannot practice agriculture, but most hunt food for their existence. The Hopi know agriculture techniques, but are forced to comply with the desert conditions of their regions and hence depend upon floodwaters to grow their maize. People also alter their environment to their advantage. Where slash and burning cultivation takes place, vegetation and bushes are burnt to fertilize the soil. Self-made embankments to retain water is a common enough way by which human beings attempt to alter their environment. Contrary to the simplistic belief that in primitive societies man only mystically perceives his environment, contemporary anthropology has demonstrated that a tribal not living in a modern society is often as an acute observer of the nature. Tribes and their patterns of adaptation. Before tribes were touched by modern civilization, they had greater mobility and roamed in a larger area. Like the Neolithic man, they always took good care to return to the soil and nutrients, and that they exhausted in growing their produce. Though the tribals had a much wider area to cultivate, even so, they would return to the same plot of land after leaving it fallow for some time before saplings were planted, so that the forest may grow again. In this way, they were able to maintain the balance in nature to their advantage. The primitive then had come to terms with nature and his environment. In some cases, he also learnt how to tame nature. This was most commonly evident in agricultural operations. The tribals know of the less obvious properties of plants, fibers, roots, stones, fish, animals, etc. They also know something about the planetary cycles, the movement of tides, weather systems, seasons, and so on. They can read signs in things. They helps them to protect the length, duration, and intensity of seasons. Natural catastrophes, pestilence, and so forth. Much of this knowledge was carried on and improved upon in folk and peasant societies. Interaction, dependence, conquest, and harmony. From Paleolithic times onwards, man has been interacting with the adapting to nature through the medium of his tools. The Paleolithic man or the Kalahari bush man may have had very simple implements such as the planting dibble, the weed cutter, or the blade bone hoe. It is with implements like these that the Paleolithic man interacted with nature for food, shelter, and clothing. From the Neolithic time onwards, the attempt has always been to try and adapt to nature on an ever increasing scale according to requirements. The development of agriculture and animal rearing, the discoveries of bronze and iron, the invention of automated machines and vehicles are all examples of our many and growing effort to conquer nature. Interaction with nature has two aspects. Number one, simple adaptation to nature, and number two, the attempt to dominate nature. Considering the vast powers of nature, what the human being have been able to tap and train to their advantage is still very small by comparison. Yet, societies today are often too aggressive in their attitude towards nature, with little realization that there are some limits and constraints on using nature. It is the nature of human beings to restlessly strive to reach new heights. But in this process, they have to reflect on their knowledge and train themselves to shape tools and technologies which are in harmony with nature and not always seek to dominate and indiscriminately destroy nature. With great despair, we notice all around us the deforestation of land and hills and the pollution of water and air. We watch with equal despair the development of industries and technologies which single-mindedly destroy our natural resources. One may not advocate a retreat from science, technology, and inventions. That would be both futile and anachronistic. The solution of our problems also lies in inventions and uses of new technologies in a manner which is friendly to and not discriminative of the surrounding ecology. Let us not forget the harsh and miserable lives of hunters and gatherers of the past and how they died helplessly and in great pain from a host of diseases. The wonders of science have helped to prolong the life of human beings, and would it not be wonderful if science could assure prolonged existence of their species? Evolution of human being as a thinking animal. As you have seen above, human beings are alone among all the species of life who are able to make and use tools according to their requirements. At the same time, they kept moving up on the ladder of evolution in the world of living. How could all this be possible? A simple answer is that all this progress till date could be possible largely owing to expansion and evolution of the thinking capabilities of human beings. Rest of this unit will address these facets in the evolution of human beings. Unique capabilities of thinking human beings. The process of evolution endowed human beings with several unique capabilities. Only they have the ability to use symbols, to think, to laugh, to question about secrets of life and death. Such abilities are not found among any other animals. Anthropologists have also been studying how these capabilities evolved in human. The large carnal brain capacity of human evolved to the present average figure of 1450 cc from 500 cc capacity, slowly over a period of 15 to 20,000 years. Comparatively, the use of language evolved faster, but it was influenced by the growth of the size of brain. Culture. Yet another distinctive feature of human beings come from the ability of humans to conceptualize and to abstract through the use of symbols. It evolved slowly with the process of biological evolution of humans, but within the span of the past 20,000 years, not the biological but the cultural evolution of humankind has come to dominate the mode of social changes. The use of language made more complex manifestations of culture possible and acquired institutionalized forms, but culture existed even before the human attained the ability to use language. The ability to communicate by using linguistic symbols liberated human beings from their physical and environmental dependence. It made it possible for them to have an objective and critical appraisal of natural and social phenomena. This ability is an essential component part of the cultural endowment of human beings. Species-specific characteristics. There are, however, similarities between human beings and animals, which psychologists like Conard Lorenz, B.F. Skinner, and others have identified. Despite many common features that humans share with other animals, human beings are unique. The uniqueness lies in their perennial quest for knowledge and their capacity to succeed in it. Perennial means continuous. We get the proof of this in the scientific discoveries and inventions that humankind has made possible since prehistoric days. The thinking ability in human beings has been made possible due to their cortical capacity and their adjustive behavior. Besides this, human beings have to go through a long period of childhood socialization. It is therefore said, child is the father of man. It is their species-specific characteristic. The brain releases human beings from dependence upon their physical and environmental situations. They used their brain power to forge tools or create objects to lessen their burden. It also gave them variable power of speech, language, and memory. The capacity to organize their experiences with a historical sensibility. Through socialization, however, human self imbibes values and norms of capacity. Norms of society, sorry. Learns its language and ability to express cognitive and emotional reactions. This socialization, however, is never complete. The plasticity of human nature makes it possible for them to innovate, improvise, and make corrective contributions. It is this ability of humankind that contributed towards scientific and technological knowledge, and through it to the march to civilization and progress. Evolution of the knowing individual. The ability to associate events and experiences through use of symbols across space and time gives human beings an insight into the cause and effect of relationship. It marks the beginning of scientific logic. In their quest for knowledge, human beings simultaneously discovered science and values. Science gave them the power to establish causality and explain the control the events of nature. The values offered them the basis to regulate their relationship with fellow human beings. Language, through which we enter into both the scientific and cultural dialogue, is a social heritage. Both science and values thus have a social character. Human beings' quest for knowledge lead them to great discoveries and scientific achievements. The technological advancement that humankind has made since the Stone Age equipment are testimony to this reality. It has been made possible through growth in their philosophical reasoning, logical skills, and methods of scientific experiments. With this advancement, the rate and volume of production of knowledge has increased manifold. One estimate is that scientific knowledge doubles every 10 years, and that this rate of growth is further on the rise. Growth of two cultures. The fast pace of growth of science has in turn created problems of its relationship with values and moral order of society. In the Western societies, scholars have expressed disappointment about the increasing gap between the scientific and the moral order of society. Instead of integration, science and moral values are showing increasing evidence of dissociation or distancing from each other. The separation of science from values not only creates two cultures, but increasingly make them run at cross purposes. We notice it in the present day race for armaments. Ecological destruction through industrialization, control over human freedom, and invention of weapons of mass annihilation like the atom bomb. Thus, for the survival and the very existence of human beings, it is necessary that the social and moral character of science is maintained. The mainstream Western tradition believes in opposition between nature and culture, or between human beings and their physical environment. In contrast to the Western tradition, Indian tradition, right from the inception, took an organic view of the relationship between scientific knowledge and its cultural or value framework. In fact, साइंस वॉज कैप इनकैप्शुलेटेड विद इन द वर्ल्ड व्यू ऑफ एथिक्स एंड द डिस्ट्रॉय ऑफ ट्रूथ सत्यम वॉज गवर्न्ड इंस्ट्रिंसिकली बाई द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ ब्यूटी सुंदरम एंड वेलफेयर शिवम सत्यम शिवम सुंदरम नो डैकोटॉमी बिटवीन द सेकर्ड एंड द प्रोफेन बिटवीन द इंस्ट्रूमेंटल एंड ट्रांसेंडेंटल और बिटवीन साइंस एंड वैल्यू वॉज एंटरटेन्ड इन द इंडियन ट्रेडिशन एंड प्रैक्टिस ऑफ साइंस द कन्वर्जिंग पॉइंट्स बिटवीन साइंस एंड रिलीजन इन द इंडियन ट्रेडिशन लाई इन द नोशन ऑफ साइंस एज योगा एंड साधना एंड द कंसेप्चुअलाइजेशन ऑफ ट्रूथ एज टेंटेटिव और पार्शियल साइंस ट्रीट्स द नेचर ऑफ ट्रूथ एज बींग टेंटेटिव एंड रिवाइजेबल विद एवर न्यू डिस्कवरीज एंड एक्सपेरिमेंट्स द क्वेस्ट ऑफ नॉलेज देयरफॉर इज पेरेनियल लगातार द इंडियन ट्रेडिशन डज नॉट सी एनी अपोजिशन बिटवीन साइंस एंड वैल्यू इट सीक्स रैदर अ यूनिटी अमॉन्ग द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ ट्रूथ गुडनेस एंड ब्यूटी सत्यम शिवम सुंदरम फॉर्म्स ऑफ नॉलेज इन ट्रांजिशन इवोल्यूशन ऑफ नॉलेज टिल डेट हैज़ पास्ड थ्रू थ्री डिस्टिंक्ट स्टेजेस ऑफ ट्रांजिशन एंड ग्रोथ एज गिवन बिलो नंबर वन मैजिकल फॉर्म ऑफ नॉलेज नॉलेज इन द फर्स्ट इंस्टेंस ग्रू थ्रू सिम्बॉलिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ नेचर सेल्फ एंड ऑफ द फेलो ह्यूमन बींग्स इट प्लेड अ सेंट्रल रोल इन डिटरमाइनिंग द ह्यूमन्स रिलेशनशिप विद बोथ नेचर एंड कल्चर फर्स्ट इट इवॉल्व इन मैजिकल एंड रिलीजियस फॉर्म्स मैजिक विच फॉर द प्रिमिटिव ह्यूमन बींग was equivalent to scientific knowledge was based on principles of causality governed by two rules. Number one, first rule was that like products like. For example, since rain is accompanied by thunder, so if one could produce something similar to thunder, rain would follow. It was common among some ancient tribes to roll down heavy boulders from hilltops to produce thunder-like sound to bring about rain. Second, the second rule was once a part, always part. It was believed that if something is done to a part of a person or his her image, the ensuing result would devolve upon that person as such. For instance, if human nail or hair could be obtained and burnt or damaged, then this bum or damage would occur also to the person to whom these parts belonged. Or if his image could be made and subjected to harm, the harm would be transferred also to the person. These laws of magic try to establish causality as sought in modern day science, but were based on the false premises. They violated the rule of validity, that is why magic is called pseudoscience. Some magical rituals and explanations of events, however, integrated with practical knowledge as these evolved through trial and error over a period of time. Magical rules were very common in all crucial economic activities such as hunting, food gathering, and agriculture. Magic was integral to other rituals related to death, birth, marriage, initiation, rites, etc. Mother goddess cult emerged from these magical rituals. The process of learning for human beings was from the very beginning related to their conceptions of nature, spirit and supernatural. A similarity between magic and modern medicine. Disease due to entry of evil spirits, outside elements in human body. In modern science, disease due to entry of germs, bacteria, and viruses. Religious beliefs grew with magical beliefs. In some cases, religious beliefs may have followed when magical principles failed. It is said that, like science, magic seeks to command nature. Religious beliefs emerge when magical commands fail to materialize. Nature on which human beings have no control inspires a supernatural awe. It is symbolically converted into religious forms of deities and made object of worship and prayer. The origin of cultural expressions such as dances, songs, dramas, and most objects of arts is attributed to some extent to early magical and religious rituals. As human culture and civilization advanced through evolution of agriculture, industry, and technology, sharp differentiation between religion and magic took place. Religion evolved in Europe into a more organized social institution, such as Roman Church and various other sects. Magic, which right from its beginning was highly individualized as a form of skill and knowledge, came under pressure both from science and religion. This was manifest from the persecution of magicians and witches in Europe during the medieval period. Wherever it survived, it did so in the form of the skill of an individual or a few persons. Separation of science and religion. With the emergence of imperial political organization, there took place large-scale growth in trade, commerce, technology, and industrial production. This is revealed through the history of ancient civilizations like those of India, China, Egypt, Greece, and Rome. With few exceptions, now a differentiation between the scientists and religious or priestly classes took place. The separation, however, was often hazy. With the decline of the Greco-Roman civilization and the rise of Christianity, church had emerged in Europe as the most powerful and social and political institution. It was a major setback to the process of differentiation between religious and scientific knowledge. All knowledge was now subject to approval of religious authority represented by the church. Its seminaries were the only institutional organizations recognized for the generation and communication of knowledge. This pattern continued for several centuries until it was challenged by forces of Renaissance and religious reformation during the 15th and 16th centuries. During this period, contributions to science made by Galileo, Copernicus and Newton and religious reforms initiated by Luther and Calvin made it possible that humanistic, rational and imperial forms of knowledge could slowly emerge. Luther and Calvin emphasized the role of individual over that of church for religious salvation. Galileo and Newton offered scientific and experimental evidence instead of theological cosmology. Slowly, the nature of seminaries, which were like theological schools, changed. These were taken out of the control of the church and taken over by the city councils of citizens for administration and cultivation of knowledge. The modern university system thus came into being on a secular basis of organization, production, and communication of knowledge. This process of secularization of knowledge in the European society took several hundred years, and it was shaped under the influence of its own social, political, cultural, and economic transformations. Division of knowledge into disciplines. What we see today as disciplines under the natural sciences, social sciences, and humanities are the result of division of knowledge which took place during the period of emergence of university system in Europe. This division is based largely on classification of reality on certain philosophical grounds. That is to say, each discipline, whether it is physics, chemistry, economies, or sociology, assumed that it had for its study a separate subject matter. However, as knowledge advanced in depth and stock, it was observed that the scope of a discipline could not be demarcated on the basis of subject matter, which may have been shared by many disciplines in that group. For example, study of individual is the subject matter for disciplines of social sciences groups. like economics, political science, sociology, etc. Does this then mean that the individual is artificially divided among these disciplines? Is the economic man different from a political or sociological man? No. The individual, which is the subject matter, cannot be fragmented among the disciplines. They are merely different because they adopt different conceptual approaches to and study different facets of the same subjects, that is the individual. That is where there lies hope for integration of knowledge, for comprehensive and understanding of the subject matter. Individual in social sciences through genuine interdisciplinary researches. Many social and natural science disciplines such as statistics, economics, chemistry and physics, etc. emerged in response to demands to solve specific needs of society. Necessity indeed was the mother of inventions, but chance discoveries, serendipity and creativity also played a role in the growth of differentiation of knowledge. All these differentiations have given rise to professional groups of vested interests into pose a major problem to the integration of knowledge. In the domain of logic, concept and method, however, significant advances have already been made during the past few decades, which point to the possibility of more and more integration of knowledge. Summary. Human beings are endowed by nature to be reflective and active. Only they and not other animals have the ability to abstract and represent their experiences through use of symbols and letters, language and other sophisticated mediums of communication. They grew with the evolution of tool-making ability evolved in course of time. In the process of evolution, stone tools and weapons were replaced by those of metals, first bronze, then iron. Each corresponding stage contributed to the growth of culture. At social organization, religious beliefs and economic institutions, occupational guilds and urban settlements emerged during the Bronze Age. The Iron Age saw the rise of complex social and political organizations. Systems of scientific knowledge, medicine, astronomy, and mathematics, which later contributed to the rise of contemporary historical civilization. Writing, which was slowly evolving during the Bronze Age, saw its fuller growth during the Iron Age. Evolution of material aspects of culture coincided with the evolution of ideas, values, and social institutions. The tool-making ability of human beings gave them door to adapt to nature as well as to control it. A part of the crisis of our civilization today is about the nature and extent of this adaptation. We have yet to establish a harmonious relationship with nature in the wake of our present-day industrial and nuclear civilization. The much talked about the topic of sustainable development is all about this critical relationships of adaptation and mutual harmony. Over these years, the ability of think grew into systematic learning and knowledge, so much so that today's society is being described as knowledge society. Magic, religion and science are the major forms which knowledge took in the course of evolution, but the forces and factors of those changes have remained quintessentially European. The perennial quest for knowledge has led human beings to great discoveries and scientific achievements, but with the exponential growth of knowledge has also come in the train emergence of the two cultures, that is the worlds of science and moral values. Both are increasingly distancing themselves from each other. Though this was typically true of the developments in the West, the Indian tradition, however, always focused on an organic, integral relationship between scientific knowledge and its cultural or value framework. Despite various vested interest groups engaged in participation of this divergence, significant advances have already been made during the past few decades to bring about integration of knowledge, for which sufficient evidences are forthcoming from the domains of logic, concept and methodology. Thank you so much for watching this video. Please like the video if you think you are going to be benefited from this video, and please subscribe to my channel so that whenever new video comes, then you can find it easily. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Have a great day.